Hello everyone, my name is Nikolaos Lamprou. I am a postdoctoral researcher from the University of Edinburgh, and today I'm going to present you Astrolabous, a universally composable time lock encryption scheme. This work is in collaboration with Myrto Arapinis, a reader from the University of Edinburgh, and from Zacharias, a postdoctoral researcher from the same institute. So first, I'm going to give you an introduction into the concept of time lock encryption. Next, I'm going to present you the related work on that field. In the third part of my talk, I'm going to discuss our research contribution, and finally, future directions on our project. So first, what's the time lock encryption? So consider the scenario in e-voting where a voter encrypts the ballot with a public key and an encryption algorithm, and the result is the encrypted ballot. Next, the voter that holds the secret key for that particular public key reveals it, and then everyone can actually use the decryption algorithm in order to retrieve the initial message. But what happens if that voter doesn't actually provide the secret key? No one can actually retrieve the initial message, and then we have fairness issues, and specifically in self-tallying protocols. So with time lock encryption, we can solve such difficulties because, again, let us consider the same scenario. We have a plaintext. Then someone encrypts the plaintext with an encryption algorithm, and instead of using a public key, it uses a specific time that this ciphertext should be open. The result is a ciphertext, and then after this time has been reached, by using the decryption algorithm and a time proof is a proof that the time has been reached. Everyone can retrieve the initial message. There are certain types of time lock encryption. The first one, it is called relativistic time, and is based on computational puzzle. So everyone that solves a puzzle can actually retrieve the initial message. The second one, it's called the absolute time lock encryption, where a witness naturally occurring from, example, the blockchain, and with an encryption witness-based scheme, someone can encrypt and actually decrypt the message. And finally, we have centralized time lock encryption schemes where a centralized authority releases time tokens, which acts as a secret key for decrypting messages on specific times. The Astrolabous, the construction that we actually provide in this work, is a relativistic time construction based on computational puzzle and specifically based on hash function that realizes our ideal functionality. Despite the fact that Astrolabous is a relativistic time, our ideal functionality captures all of these three types of time lock encryption. So I referred earlier about a time proof. But what is a time proof in a computational puzzle case? So in the computational puzzle time lock encryption schemes, we have a puzzle that needs to be solved in order for someone to be able to retrieve the initial message. This puzzle can be based in hash function or in arithmetics, for example, the repeating squaring problem. So next, the party tries and solves the puzzle and obtains the solution. The solution is the time proof, the proof that some computation has been done. And by providing the solution to the decryption algorithm, any party can actually retrieve the initial message. But ideally, in the concept of time lock encryption, we want to create an asymmetry between the puzzle generation time and the puzzle solving time. So ideally, the puzzle generation should be small and the puzzle solving should be big. Of course, there are cases and construction which these two times are equal, but are not so much of interest. So the pattern generation can be done efficiently because the computations can be parallelized, or there is a trapdoor information that can be used for speed up the computations. On the other hand, the puzzle solving is slower because no parallelization can be occurred, or there is no trapdoor information, or the entities that actually solves the puzzle are not aware of the trapdoor information. Now I'm going to speak to you about the related work in the field of time lock encryption. So first, there are time lock encryptions based on arithmetics. The first and the most well-known one, it is based on reversed et al. By that time, the authors didn't provide any formal treatment and operates as follows. The initiator of the puzzle actually encrypts the message M with a secret key K by using a symmetric encryption scheme, in that case AES. Next, the key K is hidden into a puzzle named CK. And specifically, on the key K, we add the A power 2 power T, modulo M. And because the initiator of the puzzle is aware of the factorization of N, can actually speed up the computations by computing first the E, which is equal 2 power T modulo phi ni, where phi is the Euler function. After that, can compute the B, which is the A power E. And the resulting ciphertext is a tuple, where the first argument is the composite number n, the second one is the base a, the third is the difficulty of the puzzle t, the next one is the puzzle itself, ck, and the last one is the cm, which is the result of the AES encryption. Next, we have hash-based time lock encryption puzzles. This one is proposed by Mahmoud et al. And it is based on sequential hashing. So we have a secret, x0 until xn, and the puzzle itself is a tuple, where the first argument is the value x0, the second one is the hash evaluation over the value x0, XOR the second part of the secret, which is the value x1. And this goes on the same until the value xn. It worth mentioning that this time lock puzzle scheme was not intended for encryption, as you can see, because obviously semantic security does not hold, because the puzzle, the secret, is revealing in a progressive way. Neither composable security was provided. There are also time lock encryptions based on the witness encryption. And specifically, this one is proposed by Liu et al. And is based on blockchain. So we have a statement, XT. In that case, the statement is that I know a blockchain of length T, a genesis block G, and starting difficulty D. We have a witness of that statement, which is actually this blockchain. We have a relationship U, which is actually equals 1 if the WX is the witness for the statement X, and 0 if it's not. So if someone wants to encrypt a message M based on a statement XT, it uses the encryption algorithm, which is parameterized by our relationship U, and the result is a ciphertext CT. Next, in order to decrypt that message, someone used the decryption algorithm with that ciphertext and the witness for that statement. If indeed this is the witness of that statement, the resulting value is the message M, else it is bottom. Unfortunately, the proposed construction is not efficient. There are a lack of crypto libraries that actually implement it, and the authors didn't provide any composable security arguments. Another TLE construction is one that is based on time token release. Specifically, a trusted third party releases type tokens on specific times. So, for example, if we want to encrypt the message M, and that message will be retrievable on Monday, we use the information Monday, and the result is ciphertext C. So the trusted third party releases some tokens on Monday, the blue one, on Wednesday, the green one, on Friday, the orange one. And by using the decryption algorithm with the blue token, in that case, the Mondays, anyone can retrieve the message M. These constructions are based on public key infrastructure and unfortunately are centralized. So, a natural generalization of time lock puzzles and time lock encryption in general are the verifiable delayed functions. So, in a nutshell, are time lock puzzles, but on top of that, they provide a way to verify that the resulting solution is the correct one without resolving the puzzle. Most of these constructions are based on repeating squaring. Regarding the security definitions on time lock encryption, all of them are game-based definitions. And specifically, they assume in their threat model that the adversary operates in a concrete number of steps. In contrary, if we want to study the time lock encryption primitive in the UC framework in order to argue about the composability of our protocol, someone needs to study the adversary in an asymptotic way, because this is the way the universal composable framework works. Another work in the same line with ours, recently presented in Eurocrypt, is TARDIS, a foundation of time lock puzzles in UC. The authors provide a UC definition of time lock puzzles, a construction based on a repeating squaring, and also they prove that the construction satisfies a public verifiability notion based on a definition that they provide. Despite our similarities, there are fundamental differences between our works. The first one is regarding the modeling. So, they assume that a message is revealed after specific numbers of computation has been done. We assume that a message is revealed in an absolute time, when a specific time has been reached. We believe that this captures more naturally the concept of time lock encryption, because a message is opened when a specific time has been reached, rather than when some computations has been done. Another difference is regarding the generalization. The TARDIS functionality only captures time lock encryption schemes based on computational puzzles. So the TARDIS functionality cannot model centralized constructions or witness-based encryption constructions, as we have referred. The second one is that their construction cannot model adversaries that possess an advantage on opening a message in comparison with the honest parties. And specifically, in witness-based encryption constructions, which is based on blockchain, the one that I referred earlier, because of the selfish mining, the adversary can construct a witness faster than the honest parties, and that gives it an advantage. TARDIS cannot model this. And the third one is that the construction that TARDIS provide. It is based both on the random oracle and the generic group model. In our case, our ideal functionality is more general because it's related in the absolute time rather than the computational time, which means that it captures all of the mentioned time lock encryption scheme constructions. Also, we capture this kind of situation where the adversary possesses an advantage with the leak function. Ideally, the leak function is equal to the identity, which means that the adversary doesn't possess any advantage in comparison with the honest parties. But there are also constructions which are very useful, where the adversary possesses an advantage over the honest parties. So we can capture them by parameterizing our ideal functionality with the leak function. And last, our construction, the Astrolabous, it is based only in the random oracle model. I'm going to present an attack on the public verifiability notion presented on TARDIS. So first, let us assume that we have a puzzle creator on the left, a puzzle designator on the right, and we have the server that actually solves and provides the proof of correct computations to the designated part in the middle. So the initiator of the puzzle encrypts the message M along with the trapdoor information, and the result is a ciphertext C. It sends that ciphertext C both to the server and the designated party. The server solves the puzzle and obtains the solution solved, and next, with that solution, decrypts the ciphertext CT and obtains both the message M and the trapdoor information. Then the server sends to the designated party the message M, the trapdoor information, and the solution solved, and now the designated party with a verifying function can verify that indeed the solution was correct. But what happens in case that the server is malicious, which means that solves the puzzle with a solution, decrypts the ciphertext, obtains the correct message and the correct trapdoor information, but instead of sending them, it sends another message, another trapdoor information, and another solution. Now, the designated party, when uses the verify function in order to verify that the provided solution was correct, the verification will fail. So far, so good. But the problem now is, which was the malicious party? Was the server or was the initiator of the puzzle? And unfortunately, this is something that the designated party cannot answer. In the third part of my talk, I'm going to speak about our research contribution. So, first, we define in the Universal Composable Framework the concept of time lock encryption by using an ideal functionality, and specifically the FTLE. And we capture certain security properties. The first one is the privacy. We capture it because the simulator doesn't learn anything about the message, but instead only learns the length of the message. Second, that's related with the asymmetry between the puzzle creation and the puzzle solution that I referred earlier. Because encryption also takes some time, and especially in the concept of time lock encryption, we manage to capture it by parameterizing our ideal functionality with a function delay. So if delay is zero, it means that the encryption takes zero rounds. If it's one, it means that it takes one round. Next is the correctness, where if a ciphertext is obtained twice, the functionality returns an error message, as in the case of classical public key encryption. And finally, we have our leak function, where the simulator possesses an advantage in the decryption time over the honest parties, like the Bitcoin construction that I refer. Ideally, the leak function should be equal to the identity one, which means that the simulator does not possess any advantage in comparison with the other parties when using certain encryption schemes. Of course, there are challenges on defining a puzzle-based UCTLE protocol that realizes our ideal functionality. The first challenge is related with the fact that all messages are eventually open. And specifically, the simulator receives the length of the message, so the simulator needs to encrypt a ciphertext based on something that don't know. So for that reason, the simulator just encrypts a fake message. But in the concept of time lock encryption, that message will eventually open after some time. And then when that message opens, it needs to be open to the real message, to the correct one. So how this is possible? How the simulator can manage to encrypt a fake message and opening to the correct one? The solution is using a cryptographic primitive, which is called non-committing encryption, and is based on the random oracle model. The second challenge is that the concept of time lock encryption, as I referred earlier, it is based on the concrete time. So in nature, the time lock encryption operates in a concrete time, but we need to capture the concept of time lock encryption in an asymptotic model. So first, we need to guarantee that the computation for solving the puzzle cannot be done locally, because then a Turing machine can actually solve the puzzle, any difficulty actually, in just one round. So for that reason, we based our puzzle in the random oracle model. And of course, the access to the random oracle model should be restricted. For that, we're using the functionality wrapper. So the extended time lock encryption construction that we use is as follows. When we want to encrypt a message M with difficulty T, the resulting ciphertext is a tuple, where the first argument is the result of the time lock encryption scheme we're using with R to be a random string, T to be the difficulty. The next argument is the random oracle call or the hash evaluation over the value R, XOR with a message M. Here, as you can see, because the random oracle is programmable, the simulator can equivocate and actually change the fake message to the real one. This is why we made this one of the reasons we made this extension. And the last argument is just a random oracle call on R concatenate the message M. And this actually guarantees that our scheme is non-malleable. So this is a part of the actual protocol. Each party can done two queries per round, both for puzzle creation and puzzle solving. The puzzle creation queries can be polynomial many because they can be parallelized In contrast with the puzzle solving, where it can be at most Q, because they cannot parallelize. Next, the ciphertext must broadcast it immediately, because the puzzles need to be solved. And this actually makes the connection between the absolute time and the computational time, because our ideal functionality captures the concept of time-lock encryption in an absolute time, but with our construction, in our protocol that you see realize our functionality, we use a computational time one. So that's why the parties needs to receive immediately the resulting ciphertext and starting to solve it, so that when the time comes, the computation will be done, and thus the message can be opened. So, in order to link the provided algorithm and the UC definition, we define a game-based definition, which is called Q security. The Q security states that it is hard to reverse the challenge message before the time comes. This captures only one-wayness and not semantic security, but with the equivocal extension in the random oracle that I referred earlier is enough for having a UC realization. So we have our first theorem, which states that if the provided time lock encryption algorithm satisfies our game-based definition, then we have a UC realization. So now I'm going to present you Astrolabous. The idea behind Astrolabous is that we combine the time lock puzzle of Mahmoudi, and specifically we hide in the time lock puzzle a key K, as in the first tab, in the first argument of the tuple is the value x0 until the value xn, and in the last argument is the XOR of the last of these x's, XORed with a key K. So in order for someone to retrieve the key, must actually compute in a sequential way all of these hash evaluations, like in Mahmoudi. But instead of hiding the key K across all of the puzzle and retrieving a part of it each time, we hide it at once in the final argument. And secondly, we use a symmetric key encryption scheme, for example, IS, to hide the message M by using the key K, like in reversed. And the result is the Astrolabous. As you can see, it is based solely on the random oracle model, in contrast with reverse, that is based both in the generic group model and the random oracle one. It is public verifiable without the knowledge of any trapper information, because the entity that actually solves the puzzle can provide all of the hash evaluation, and any third party at once and in parallel can evaluate them and actually see if the solution is it matches. Also, the puzzle generation doesn't require any knowledge of any trapdoor information, because all of the computations can be parallelized and the time is proportional to the number of the CPU cores. Regarding the security of Astrolabous, we have a theorem that states that Astrolabous satisfies the Q security. So Astrolabous, if is included in the protocol that we referred earlier, can you serialize our ideal functionality? But what happens if we want to study the security of Astrolabous outside of the UC framework, for example, in a standalone setting? Is the Q security enough? The answer is no, because as I refer, semantic security does not hold, because Q-security only stress the one-way property. So for that reason, we define an in-CPA style game-based definition, but in the time lock setting. And Astrolabous satisfies it. In the last part of my talk, I'm going to speak to you about our future directions. So first is to improve the scalability of Astrolabous. And specifically, we have the puzzle generation, which can be parallelized and is proportional in the number of CPU calls. Based on an early benchmarking, we found that for an average computer which possesses 4 to 6 cores, a 12-hour puzzle can be generated in 1 to 2 hours, which is not practical. So our idea is instead of using a CPU, we can use a GPU, where the number of cores are many more, but the architecture and the way that GPU solves a problem is way different. So for that reason, we need benchmarking. Regarding our second research direction, when we actually create a time lock puzzle with Astrolabous, we need to be sure that someone will not take advantage of the hardware acceleration and solve the puzzle faster. For that reason, we will enhance Astrolabous and make it memory hard, which means that the CPU fetches data from RAM all the time because cannot predict which data is actually the correct one. And this is expensive even for a dedicated hardware. We will gonna borrow ideas from the balloon hashing paper so that we can predict more safely the correct parameters for the puzzle creation. But more research needs to be done, not for applying and enhance Astrolabous with this construction, but also we need to be sure that the puzzle generation is efficient. This is the reference, and thank you for your attention.